Hi, good morning children. Welcome back to the English classes. I hope you all have got your notes that I have sent through the parent app. But I have sent it together actually. The Sound of Music together. Evelyn Glennie and Bismillah Khan together. You can take your own time and write. We'll be doing the Shehnai of Bismillah Khan today. I hope you all have read about Evelyn Glennie. We have done Evelyn Glennie. In this chapter, The Sound of Music, we'll be learning about, we have already learned about one musician, Evelyn Glennie, and the next one is the Shehnai of Bismillah Khan. It's all about Ustad Bismillah Khan. Who is an Ustad? An Ustad is a maestro, is a distinguished performer. So you're going to learn about the Shehnai of Bismillah Khan. Shehnai is an instrument, musical instrument. Okay. So, you can see in part 2, the Shehnai of Bismillah Khan. As an introduction, the pictures of various musicians are given here. You have to identify the musicians and write the names in the text itself. Do you know these people? What instruments do they play? You are asked to find out the names of these musicians given in the picture, page 21 of your text. And you are asked to write the names of instruments that they play. Please see the pictures. You can ask someone. Or you can do a research in that and write about the instruments. Or just the name of the instruments is enough. Now, think of the Shehnai. And the first thing you will probably imagine is a wedding or a similar occasion or function. Whenever you hear about Shehnai, the first thing that comes to your mind is an auspicious occasion or a wedding. Or a similar occasion, a special occasion. On special occasions, Shehnai is played, like our Nadaswaram. Nadaswaram is an indispensable part of any any Keralite wedding. So the next would probably be Ustad Bismillah Khan, the Shehnai maestro, playing this instrument. So which instrument did he play? Shehnai. Let us learn about Ustad Bismillah Khan, Shehnai, and how Shehnai got its name, how good a performer Bismillah Khan was, what did he do, what was the contributions, what are the contributions given by Bismillah Khan to the world of music. Now the first para. Emperor Aurangzeb banned the playing of a musical instrument called pungi in the royal residence, for it had a shrill, unpleasant sound. See, you might have heard about Emperor Aurangzeb, a very strict ruler. Banned the playing of a musical instrument. He actually banned it. Said that nobody should play that instrument because it gave out an unpleasant sound. He was so much irritated hearing the unpleasant sound of the pungi. So it was an order from the emperor and everybody stopped playing pungi. Pungi became the generic name for reeded noisemakers. What is generic? A particular name given to a class. Generic name means a name given to a class or group as a whole. So this generic is actually generic means it's an adjective. What part of speech it comes? It's an adjective, generic adjective. What is the noun form of that? Genre. G-E-N-R-E, genre of a particular class or order. Pronunciation is genre. Whereas in adjective form, it is called generic name for reeded noisemakers. Generic name for reeded noisemakers. What's a reed? Reed, it's something of a wind instrument, reeded noisemakers. So pungi became the generic name for reeded noisemakers. So it was banned by Emperor Aurangzeb. few had thought that it would one day be revived. Some of them thought that it would be brought back. Understood? A barber of a family of professional musicians who had access to the royal palace. So the story goes like this. After it was banned, a barber, who is a barber? Hairdresser, barber of a family of professional musicians who had access to the royal palace, decided to improve the tonal quality of the punki. As it irritated the emperor, he decides to improve the tonal quality, the tone of the instrument. He chose a pipe with a natural hollow stem that was longer and broader than the punki. See, the shape was actually changed. You can see in the picture on the next page how the punki looked and how the shehnai looks. Okay, the tonal quality was improved and also the shape. He chose a pipe with a natural hollow stem that was longer and broader than the punki and made 7 holes on the body of the pipe. You can see the pipe and the holes made on the body of the pipe, 7 holes. Closing and opening some of these holes, soft and melodious sounds were produced. So, whenever it closed and opened, soft and melodious sounds were produced. He played the instrument before royalty. Royalty means in front of the king, emperor. And everyone was impressed. Whenever something need to be introduced, the first thing was that it should be played before the emperor and the royalty. And everyone was impressed hearing the tone, the improvisation made to the instrument. The instrument, so different from the punki, had to be given a new name. The next task was to give a new name to the instrument. As the story goes, here goes the story. Since it was first played in the Shah's chambers, means in front of the royalty, and was played by a Nai, barber, the instrument was named the Shehnai. In front of the Shah, Shah. Nai, played by a barber. So thus it got its name. So remember the words, glossary words given here, the generic name, read it. In para 1, 2 words, generic name, and read it. Melodious, punki, shehnai, professional musicians, all these remember. Who banned the playing of the musical instrument punki? Emperor Aurangzeb. Remember all that. For your extract, questions will be asked from each para. You have to read the paras thoroughly. Shall we move on to the second para? The sound of the shehnai began to be considered auspicious. What's the meaning of auspicious, children? That which brings good luck, promising good fortune. An auspicious occasion is an occasion very special that brings you good luck. And for this reason, it is still played in temples. Now also it is played in temples because it is considered as something played for auspicious occasions, like for a marriage or any other function in the temple. And for this reason, it is still played in temples and is an indispensable component of any North Indian wedding. Indispensable meaning without which a piece of work cannot be done. You cannot avoid that. It has become an indispensable component of any North Indian wedding. Means it became very important in any North Indian wedding. In the past, the shehnai was part of the naubat, or traditional ensemble. See, the word pronounced ensemble is ensemble. Means it's a group. It's a group of instruments being played. Naubat means, now in Hindi means 9, a group of 9 instruments. The shehnai was part of those 9 instruments, one among the 9 instruments at royal courts. So remember, in the past, the Shehnai was part of the Naubad, or traditional ensemble of 9 instruments found at royal courts. Till recently, it was used only in temples and weddings. The credit for bringing this instrument onto the classical stage goes to Usta Bismillah Khan. So this is the introduction, how Shehnai was introduced into the classical stage. I mean, who introduced that? Ustad Bismillah Khan. Who is an Ustad? A maestro, a distinguished performer. Now you're going to learn about Ustad Bismillah Khan, Para 3. As a 5-year-old, Bismillah Khan played Gilli Danda near a pond in the ancient estate of Dumra in Bihar. Gilli Danda is a game like cricket, baseball. A long stick is used to hit an oval-shaped wooden piece. Understood? Something like baseball or cricket. And children used to play in the streets in those times. As a 5-year-old, Bismillah Khan played Gilli Danda near a pond in the ancient estate of Dumra in Bihar. He would regularly go to the nearby Bihariji temple to sing the Bhojpuri Chaita. He used to go and sing in the temples. Though he was a devout Muslim, he used to go to the temple to sing the Bhojpuri Chaita, at the end of which he would earn a big laddu weighing 1.25 kg, a prize given by the local Maharaja. So he just wanted to sing and get the laddu from the Maharaja. That was his gift. This happened 80 years ago. The writer says, this happened 80 years ago. And the little boy has traveled far to earn the highest civilian award in India, the Bharat Ratna. So, if he got a laddu as a prize, as a gift after singing before 80 years, now he has possessed, he has got the highest civilian award in India, the Bharat Ratna. Now you are going to learn about Bismillah Khan's childhood. Born on 21st March 1916, Bismillah belongs to a well-known family of musicians from Bihar. So remember, he belonged to a family of musicians. His grandfather, Rasool Bakhsh Khan, was the Shehnai Nawaz of the Bhojpur King's Court. So remember the names, Rasool Bakhsh Khan, Bismillah Khan's grandfather, who was the Shehnai Nawaz of the Bhojpur King's Court. His father, Paigambar Bakhsh, and other paternal ancestors. Paternal ancestors means ancestors belonging to your father's side. His father, Paigambar Bakhsh, and other paternal ancestors were also great Shehnai players. So the writer says here that his grandfather, father, and paternal ancestors were all great musicians. Let us go on to the next page. The young boy took to music early in life. The young boy here is Bismillah Khan. Took to music. He was very much interested in music. At the age of 3, when his mother took him to his maternal uncle's house. Who is your maternal uncle? Your mother's brother. Your uncle from your mother's side. Maternal. In the previous para, you have learned paternal ancestors. Father's side. Here, maternal uncle. Maternal uncle's house in Benares. Benares is now called Varanasi. Bismillah was fascinated watching his uncles practice the Shehnai. So those people were also musicians. So father's side and mother's side were full of musicians. Soon, Bismillah started accompanying his uncle, Ali Bakhsh. Uncle here is maternal uncle, Ali Bakhsh, to the Vishnu temple of Benares, where Bakhsh was employed to play the Shehnai. So his job was to play Shehnai every day in the temple. That is Ali Bakhsh, his uncle. Ali Bakhsh would play the Shehnai and Bismillah would sit captivated for hours on end. What is the meaning of captivated? he would be enchanted sitting there as if in a trance or dream world. He would be sitting listening to his uncle playing the shehnai, would sit captivated for hours on end. When will you use wood? When will you use wood, children? When you see wood, you use when you have been you, when you used to do something in the past. So Bismillah used to sit captivated for hours on end with his uncle. That wood and used to is something that you have done for a long time in the past but stop doing now. Used to and wood, remember the use of wood and used to. You use that word, those words, with things done in the past. You have been doing in the past for a long time but have stopped doing it now. Sit captivated for hours on end. Slowly he started getting lessons in playing the instrument and would sit practicing throughout the day. See, that much interested he was in learning and practicing. For the whole day, throughout the day, he used to sit and practice. Practicing verb form, you use practicing, practicing throughout the day. So what is the meaning of would sit captivated for hours on end? Hours on end means for a long time without stopping. At that age, he used to sit and practice for long hours. Can you imagine? Slowly, he started getting lessons in playing the instrument and would sit practicing throughout the day. For years to come, the temple of Balaji and Mangalamaya and the banks of the Ganga became the young apprentice's favorite haunts, where he could practice in solitude. See, for years to come, the temple of Balaji and Mangalamaya and the banks of the Ganga. Banks of the Ganga means Bismillah Khan's favorite haunt. He loved sitting on the banks of Ganga and playing shehnai for hours together. Became the young apprentice's favorite haunts. Young apprentice here mentioned is Bismillah Khan. Who is an apprentice? A trainee in a trade. Here he is a trainee in music. From his uncle, uncle and paternal and maternal ancestors, he has inherited the trades, love for music, and now he is getting practice, and so he is called young apprentice. Favorite haunts. Favorite haunts means the banks of Ganga and the temples mentioned here, where he could practice in solitude. Solitude means all alone. In peace, he used to sit and play shehnai and also improvise and invent new ragas too. The flowing waters of the Ganga inspired him to improvise and invent ragas that were earlier considered to be beyond the range of the shehnai. Only few, very few ragas and only very little music used to be played in shehnai, but he has changed. He brought about a change in all that, and he started improvising and inventing new ragas because the flowing waters of the Ganga inspired him. Hearing the flowing waters, he heard music in the flowing waters of Ganga too. That much music was there in his blood. Just like Evelyn Glennie, he also breathed music. Now let us go on to the sixth para. At the age of 14, Bismillah accompanied his uncle to the Allahabad Music Conference. At the end of his recital, recital means the performance, Ustad Faiz Khan patted the young boy's back and said, "Work hard and you shall make it. If you work hard, you will achieve. You shall make it." So please remember the words. Please remember the words. Work hard. Work hard and you shall make it. Ustad Faiz Khan. With the opening of the All India Radio in Lucknow. All India Radio. You know, have you all visited? Anyone has visited this All India Radio in Thiruvananthapuram? In Vadidakkad? Here, with the opening of the All India Radio in Lucknow in 1938, came Bismillah's big break. What is a break? It's a turning point in one's life. He soon became an often heard Chennai player on radio. So he soon became an often heard. That honor was conferred on him. He got a chance to play Chennai every day on radio. So now, let us go on to the summary. Till para 6, and I'm going to read the whole of that summary, the whole of that part 2, the origin of Chennai. The story goes like this. Pungi was a reeded instrument, I told, a wind instrument. It had a shrill and unpleasant sound. Emperor Aurangzeb banned its playing in his palace, but a Nai made a similar instrument which produced melodious sound. It was named Chennai. It was made of a broader and longer hollow reed and had 7 holes on its body. Remember the picture given in your text. Now, the popularity of Chennai. Chennai became popular. It began to be considered auspicious because it was played on occasions that brought good luck. It is still played in temples and at weddings. In the modern times, Ustad Bismillah Khan has so perfected its music that it has become classical. Remember, he invented new ragas, improvised. Bismillah Khan's love of Chennai. Bismillah Khan belongs to a family of Chennai players. He was born on 2nd March 1916 in Dumraon in Bihar. At the age of 3, his mother took him to his maternal uncle's house in Benares. He started with his uncle practicing the Chennai and was fascinated. His uncle gave him lessons in playing the Chennai, and Bismillah started practicing in the temple of Balaji and Mangalamaya and on the banks of the Ganga. Hearing the flowing waters, he invented new ragas. He created new ragas which were earlier considered to be beyond the scope of the Chennai. Now, how his skill was recognized first. At the age of 14, Bismillah Khan accompanied his uncle to a music conference at Allahabad. There he played the Chennai and was admired by everybody. In 1983, he began to play the Chennai. In 1938, he began to play the Chennai on All India Radio, Lucknow, the inauguration of All India Radio. He had got the honor to greet the independent nation from the Red Fort with the auspicious music of the Chennai on August 15, 1947, on the previous day of independence, actually at night. He had the honor to greet the independent nation from the Red Fort with the auspicious music of the Chennai on August 15, 1947. We'll read the rest of the summary and do the rest of the lesson in the next class. Now, let us watch a video on Bismillah Khan.
The Chennai of Bismillah Khan. Emperor Aurangzeb banned the playing of a musical instrument called Pungi in the royal residence, for it had a shrill, unpleasant sound. Pungi became the generic name for reeded noisemakers. The Chennai of Bismillah Khan. Emperor Aurangzeb banned the playing of a musical instrument called Pungi in the royal residence, for it had a shrill, unpleasant sound. Pungi became the generic name for reeded noisemakers. Few had thought that it would one day be revived. A barber of a family of professional musicians who had access to the royal palace decided to improve the tonal quality of the pungi. He chose a pipe with a natural hollow stem, that was longer and broader than the pungi, and made 7 holes on the body of the pipe. When he played on it, closing and opening some of these holes, soft and melodious sounds were produced. He played the instrument before royalty, and everyone was impressed. The instrument, so different from the pungi, had to be given a new name. As the story goes, since it was first played in the Shah's chambers and was played by a Nai, that is Baba, the instrument was named the Shehnai. The sound of the Shehnai began to be considered auspicious, and for this reason, it is still played in temples and is an indispensable component of any North Indian wedding. In the past, the Shehnai was part of the Naubad, or traditional ensemble of 9 instruments found at royal courts. Till recently, it was used only in temples and weddings. The credit for bringing this instrument onto the classical stage goes to Ustad Bismillah Khan. As a 5-year-old, Bismillah Khan played Gilli Danda near a pond in the ancient estate of Dumrao in Bihar. He would regularly go to the nearby Bihari Ji temple to sing the Bhojpuri Chhaida, at the end of which he would earn a big laddu weighing 1.25 kilograms, a prize given by the local Maharaja. This happened 80 years ago, and the little boy has traveled far to earn the highest civilian award in India, the Bharat Ratna. Born on the 21st of March 1916, Bismillah belongs to a well-known family of musicians from Bihar. His grandfather, Rasool Bakhsh Khan, was the Shehnai Nawaz of the Bhojpur King's Court. His father, Paighambar Bakhsh, and other paternal ancestors were also great Shehnai players. The young boy took to music early in life. At the age of 3, when his mother took him to maternal uncle's house in Banaras, now Varanasi, Bismillah was fascinated watching his uncles practice the Shehnai. Soon Bismillah started accompanying his uncle Ali Bakhsh to the Vishnu temple of Banaras, where Bakhsh was employed to play the Shehnai. Ali Bakhsh would play the Shehnai, and Bismillah would sit captivated for hours on end. Slowly, he started getting lessons in playing the instrument and would sit practicing throughout the day. For years to come, the temple of Balaji and Mangala Maya and the banks of the Ganga became the young apprentice's favorite haunts, where he could practice in solitude. The flowing waters of the Ganga inspired him to improvise and invent ragas that were earlier considered to be beyond the range of the Shehnai. At the age of 14, Bismillah accompanied his uncle to the Allahabad Music Conference. At the end of his recital, Ustad Fayaz Khan patted the young boy's back and said, "Work hard and you shall make it." With the opening of the All India Radio in Lucknow in 1938, came Bismillah's big break. He soon became an often heard Shehnai player on radio.